All right, thank you all for coming again this week. And just to explain for the people who are listening to this, what we do is, this is a question and answer study where the people here live with me will be asking me questions on any topic they are interested about in related to the scriptures or the Bible or Dead Sea Scrolls, and I will answer from my perspective of the faith that I converted to. I have attempted to convert to the Dead Sea Scroll faith. I have tried to restore that ancient path. That is the faith that I try to follow for my life, and I find it very meaningful and close to the truth from what I've seen, and I hope my understanding, based principally on the scrolls, will be able to help people find the truth better and to get closer to God in their studies. Hold on 1 second. Sorry for the delay. That's what this is about. So, do you guys have any questions on your mind right now? If you do, please ask these questions in the box where you can type. And if you don't have any questions, let me know so that I can. Because what we've done in other sessions is, when people did not have any more questions, then basically I just was thinking of various things that came to my mind just on the spur of the moment, whatever came to my mind on, and that makes it very interesting too. But so if you guys have questions, please share. But if you don't, then I'll just discuss whatever comes to my mind. I'll wait a little bit to see if you have any questions you put in. Seems like people don't have any questions right now. If questions start coming to you, then feel free to type the questions. But okay, some questions are being asked now. And if you have other questions too, please type them in as I'm answering, because it'll help. It'll help to have as many questions stacked up so that I can answer the first questions, and then if there's already questions waiting, then I can move right into the next question. So the first question is asked by David, and it is, what is your thought on tithing? Is it money? Is it for us? Basically, if I understand the question correctly, what exactly is tithing, and are we supposed to be doing tithing? Is that still something that's required of us believers? And from what I've seen, that the tithing, there were different tithes commanded in the scriptures. And what we see is one of the tithes was specifically designated for the priests themselves, and another tithe was for the poor people and those in need. That's what the law Moses says, and then another one was specifically for yourselves to observe the holy times. It was funds set apart for what was needed to keep the feasts, and those are called the three tithes: the first tithe, the second tithe, and the third tithe. And many of the writings, including in the scrolls, speak of these tithes. Now, a tithe is a 10%, if I understand correctly, and it is the best of your, it is the principle, the first fruits of what you have. And it's not just money. It is basically whatever you gain, your gains. Okay, your gains are tithed. So let's say you have $100. It would not be correct for that to be tithed perpetually, so that the first year you pay 10%, and then the next year you pay 10% on the $100 you still have, and then it doesn't work like that. It's any new money or any new possessions you come into possession of, then you set aside that 10%, and then in the Dead Sea Scrolls they actually have a tithe, but it wasn't a 10%. It was like I forget the exact percentage, but basically it's something like 1/15 or something like that. It is for the leaders of your community. That's what the Dead Sea Scrolls says. It is for the people who are the leaders, and because it's very similar to what we have in our U.S. society of mayors. Okay, mayors have a job to do. They have a job to oversee the people. And then there's police and stuff like that. So there's all these people who are working for your city or your community. Who pays for that? Well, that's what taxes are for. It's a similar thing. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, that's what there's a special extra tithe or tax, and that is designated to your community leaders. Your community leaders are your religious overseers who are not only teaching you, but they are also watching over the community as if they were mayors, police, and such like that. So they have to get paid because they are doing a full-time job for the community. And that's the way of paying them through that. Now, there is also a tithe system in some of the New Testament writings for bishops, elders, and I think deacons as well, maybe. It's basically, again, it's the same type of principle of these people are your overseers. You are part of their community, and they are doing a full-time job to take care of the people. And so that is for them, so that they can continue to do their crucial job, because without them, the community cannot function. Now, is it for us? I believe it is, but there are certain things, you know, obviously we can't do. Like, we can't do the tithe for the Levites. That's not for us, because the Levites are not doing their job currently, so that's not needed. Second one is tithe for the holy things, like participating in the holy festivals. Again, that one cannot be done. Third one can be done, and that is for the poor people. That is still those who need it. You know, that is still a what the law says. That's something that we can still do. And then there's the New Testament, like, you know, the bishops and stuff like that. And if you had true bishops who were following the scriptures and following the way that the Dead Sea Scrolls commands and the law in the New Testament, then it would be valid and right to give a tithe to those leaders, and they would be the leaders of your community. And how this functioned was, it wasn't just like how the Christians do it today, where they go to church, like, you know, they go to church on Sunday and then that's it. This was something where you were immersed into it every day of your life. You were part of that community. It was like a family, and you were fellowshipping together every day, and you were dwelling in a common place, in a neighborhood, in a sense, or a community, and your overseers would help to help take care of you, and they would do the various things that our local leaders do, like, as I said, mayors, police, all different types of functions, they have job duties. It's not just a preaching on Sunday and that gets them money. No, it is, they're doing hard work and labor for the community to make sure it's has law and order and that it is thriving, and it's like a manager position in a sense. You know, it's a management, and that can be a very difficult job. So that is pretty much what it's for. So if you have a community that's true and faithful to the scriptures, then the tithe is absolutely valid, and you should be supporting those people with what you're able to. And that's my stance on it. Hopefully that answers the question. That's what the scroll people would do. They would support their overseers, their community leaders. Now, the people in the Dead Sea Scroll community, this was asked by Anne. She asks, the Dead Sea Scroll community, did they perform animal sacrifices? I believe originally they did, but then the evidence seems to point to in the first century they stopped doing the sacrifices. They stopped doing the animal sacrifices in the according to their Essene writings, there are some writings that were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and these writings tell us that the sacrifices are going to be stopped. They're going to be put to an end when the Holy of Holies is going to be defiled, and it prophesies of the priesthood being defiled as well, and this is also in Daniel. In the book of Daniel, chapter 9, it tells us that there's going to be a covenant, and the sacrifices of that covenant are going to be put to a stop. So the Essenes interpreted that as they are no longer to participate in the Jerusalem sacrifices. They did their own sacrifices, but they weren't doing animal sacrifices in the first century. After the death of the Messiah, they were no longer participating in that function. And then when the temple was destroyed, the second temple, they were definitely not doing animal sacrifices anymore. They ended it. So in their writings, in the Dead Sea Scrolls, they believe the sacrifices are required. But they also believe they have to be done in the correct, lawful way. And because they weren't able to do it in the lawful way anymore, they were not doing the sacrifices. And they disagreed with those who were doing the animal sacrifices because they knew that those people were not doing it in the way that the law requires. They weren't doing it purely. By that time, the priesthood had become bought out by the Romans. It was corrupted by the Roman Herodian line, and it was not following the law of Moses. It wasn't following the way of holiness. So originally, when they were first founded, they were doing the sacrifices. But then, as it progressed, the priesthood started getting too corrupt, and they stopped doing the sacrifices. They stopped participating with the Jerusalem temple system. What they did though for the Jerusalem temple system is they still gave some of their tithes and dedicated offerings to the people there. But they were no longer doing animal sacrifices there. But they were still trying to participate in the temple until it was destroyed. Once the temple was destroyed, then that was it. I'm going to go through each of these questions. So I'll just hold on because some people asked other questions a little bit later. I'll get to those. Let's see. Let's see here. Okay, so here's a question asked of the what books were contained in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, I've done some overviews of the Dead Sea Scrolls in the other studies, but I'll be happy to do it again. But I'm not going to do it as in-depth as I did the other times. But basically, to give you an overview of the Dead Sea Scrolls, we've got some Enochian writings. So, like, Book of Enoch was found, Book of Giants. So, and then we have the Patriarchal writings. So there was the Book of Lamech, which is the father of Noah. We found that. We found a Book of Noah, which was written by Noah himself, I believe. It claims to be written by Noah himself. And then Book of Abraham was also found. So these are patriarch writings. And then there were writings by the patriarchs of like their final words near the end of their life, the testaments. So there was the testaments of the 12 sons of Jacob. There was the last words of Moses' grandfather, that his name was Kohath. And then there was also the last words of Amram, who was Moses' father. And that was found in the scrolls in several copies. So we've got we have those. We have the books of Moses, but much longer. There's fuller stuff and many extra laws, for example. And it's just a very different version of the law of Moses. I mean, you've got the whole Old Testament, with the exception of the Book of Esther, but I believe that was just an accident that it wasn't found yet. I believe they did have that book there, but it just we haven't discovered it in the fragments yet. So they had the Old Testament, those books were in a different form often, especially the Book of Psalms. Their Book of Psalms was very different. They also were strongly Davidic, so that they had so many extra Psalms of David, like not just the Book of Psalms, they had a bunch of other Psalms that David wrote. Psalms for the Sabbath sacrifice, Psalms for all kinds of other things. We find a lot in there. But there a lot of it's fragmentary, unfortunately. So those are some other portions. Then you've got some more Proverbs, similar to the Book of Proverbs, which is, so this book was probably, some of these fragments were probably written by Solomon himself. They're so similar to Solomon's words. So there's some proverb wisdom type of writings found in the scrolls. Then there's also some prophet books. They are the Book of Ezekiel. There's another Book of Ezekiel, which is a very amazing book. It's only in fragments though, but what has been survived is amazing stuff. There's some fragments of the Book of Jeremiah. And there's some fragments from various other unknown prophets, just some amazing prophecies. And some of the prophecies are like clear prophecies of the Messiah himself. And then others are prophecies of things that are going on in our time right now. The how corrupt society is. It fits very well with the way the world is. So that's other parts of the scrolls. There's calendar documents, which focus on how the calendar functions. There's commentaries that the Essenes wrote themselves. They were called the Pesher documents, and there's other commentaries that they did. They also had their own community rule documents where they went through they presented what they believed was the new covenant and the rules for their community, and these were the laws that the Essenes believed they had to follow. They not all these laws were found in the Law of Moses or in older books. Some of them were specifically newly revealed to these people, these Essenes, because they functioned as prophets. They considered themselves prophets. And so some of their new ideas they wrote down in these books and presented them as books of prophecy. And including that would be the War Scroll. So that's a basic overview of what was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's a very simplified version of it. There's just so much amazing depth in these documents. Let me see here. Yeah, and the question was, who do you believe stored or hid them there and why? Why were the Dead Sea Scrolls stored where they were and who hid them there? I believe it was the Essenes. And why they hid them there, it seems to be the case. Perhaps it's not 100% certain, but it seems the most likely explanation is that they knew the Romans were coming, and the Romans would try to destroy the scriptures, and they had a very holy view of the scriptures, and they knew that these were important and need to be preserved, and so they buried them in honor and respect so that they wouldn't be destroyed. That's my take on it. It's also possible that because they were prophets, that they knew if they buried them there, they knew in advance that people were going to find them over a thousand years later. So these are all different possibilities. We don't know for certain why they put them there, but that seems to be likely the case, to hide them, to protect them, and preserve them. And these documents are so united in a theme, they have to be writings from the same group. And the reason why would be, imagine if some random person has a library, and he has writings from Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, Judaism, writings from all over the place, pagan, like Greek mythology, you know. All this together, putting it into a library. You're going to find something about this library. The writings are completely contrary to one another. There's not a flowing together. There's not a theme. It's just completely random. People from all different types of groups writing about stuff, and it's all collected together. That's not what we see in the Dead Sea Scrolls. What we see is the writings have a unity, a theme, a strong connection to one another, which shows that it wasn't just a random collection of writings, but this was a collection of writings that was considered sacred and foundational to a group of people, to a single religious group. And from my studies, I'm strongly of the conviction that these people were the same identity as the Essenes that Josephus refers to. And is there any evidence that the apostles of Yeshua were the ones who put them there? I think that the evidence is unlikely that they were the ones who put them there. I mean, you know, it's always technically possible, but there's no hard evidence for that. And there's no real evidence that there was any New Testament writings in these scrolls either. All we found was Old Testament writings and apocrypha from the Old Testament times. So it seems unlikely that the apostles were the one who buried them, but at the same time, it seems to me that the apostles were very much involved with the community that was still in this area, in the area that the scrolls were found. And so it might have been buried by, perhaps, it could have been buried by believers in the Messiah. But I wouldn't necessarily say it was the apostles, because the apostles, remember, were spread out everywhere. They were sent out to specific communities and countries where they were to preach. So if it was going to be anyone who was the followers of the Messiah, it would have been some random people, probably. It probably would not have been the chief leaders like the apostles. Let's see. In my understanding, the people had an obligation to take care of the people, of the poor people, for instance. That was an obligation to help people. And according to the Dead Sea Scroll documents, for their community rules, they believed that everyone was to hand over, again, it was something like maybe 1/15 of your wages. And it's to help the community. So I also need to emphasize strongly that the Dead Sea Scroll version of the Torah is much longer, has many extra laws. So we have to be careful saying something is not required in the Torah because it's not in our copies of Torah. Because the problem is so many laws from the Torah have been removed based on the Dead Sea Scrolls. If the Dead Sea Scrolls are the closest to the originals, then those prove that the original version of the law was much larger, had many extra laws, which are now no longer in our copies of the Torah. And so I trust the Dead Sea Scroll writers on their understanding of the law and the commandments that we have to follow. And the law also speaks of taking care of the poor people. And so to me, I understand the the requirements to be that. What, remember I said there was three tithes, and one of those tithes is taking care of the poor people. And so, how do you take care of poor people? I don't think it's necessarily just donating animals to them. Because a poor person who doesn't have land, he won't be able to use an animal to help himself. It seems that there is a need to for that tithe for the poor. There is a need to assist them in a more tangible way and one that's more helpful to them, rather than solely on agricultural products and livestock. But I'd have to do more study on it to make sure, you know, what exactly needs to be tithed. You know, is it only is it because Anne was saying in the comments, in her understanding of the law, the law only requires tithes or levies on agricultural products and livestock. And I'm gonna look into that more for myself to make sure whether or not that's true. I need to, because I'm not certain that's the case, but I don't want to necessarily say that she's absolutely wrong either, because I haven't looked into it in a long time. I forget what the Torah says exactly on the issue, but I do know what the scrolls say about taking care of the people and handing over like a 15th or something of your wages to help the people. Hopefully that gives some good stuff to understand the scrolls. Let's see here. I'm just reading the other things people were saying. Okay. So I've gone through everything so far. Do you guys have other things on your mind? Or as of now, there's nothing specifically that you are thinking of? Because if there's nothing that is on your mind, then I can share with you some very interesting things on the topics that come to my mind. I have certain ideas that I can use as a main segue to present some of the scriptures to you to show you some amazing things. But I want to make sure that I answer your guys' questions before I go into any different topic. So I'll wait for a second to see if you guys have any questions. All right. John thinks he would like to hear what I had to share, but I just want to give people a last chance. Do you are there any questions on your mind right now? And if there's not, then I'll go into a different subject. But as I go into a different subject, please feel free to ask questions. It can be completely unrelated to what I'm saying. Questions on anything, and as I'm going through this other study, then I can take a break and go back to your questions, okay? Because this, I just want it to be whatever you guys want to hear about. Basically, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be going through for you guys through the Book of Proverbs, because I want to, this is an amazing book, because The copies of Book of Proverbs in the Hebrew Bible, the Masoretic text that the Jews preserved for us and that most people's Bibles read today, are very different from the Bibles that the Septuagint preserved of Proverbs and that the Greeks preserved. And so basically, you've got, of all believers of the Bible today, you have the Jews, Protestants, Messianics, Catholics. Those are the main people who are kind of grouped together, and they follow the Masoretic text, the Hebrew text that the rabbis did, the Pharisee rabbis. Then you've got the Eastern Orthodox and the Oriental Orthodox, and then the Dead Sea Scrolls. Those all follow more along the lines of the Septuagint. Not the Dead Sea Scrolls does not always follow the Septuagint, but very often it does. And so you sort of have the two camps. You have the rabbi camp and the Septuagint camp. And it is from my study that the Septuagint, most of the time, not 100% of the time, but most of the time, is much better than the rabbi version that everyone else is pretty much used to. So the version you guys read, almost without a doubt, you are missing so much from your version of the book, of like every book of the Old Testament, because you're following the rabbi version that's based on the Masoretic text, the Hebrew. The Greek version, people don't like the Greek because they think, oh, Greek's pagan. But here's the key. The Greek was made from the Jews, ancient times, who translated the Hebrew scriptures into Greek. So just like we're using English now, English is not the holy language, but it was translated from Hebrew into English. In the same way, it was translated in the ancient times from Hebrew into Greek. But that translation into Greek had access to Hebrew manuscripts, which were much better than our Hebrew manuscripts. Their Hebrew manuscripts were very similar to the Dead Sea Scrolls. Not exact, but they were much closer. And so, because the Septuagint has evidence of a much better Hebrew text for many of these books, I believe we should be taking seriously into consideration what the Septuagint says, and then almost all the time we should be following what the Septuagint says. But not 100% of the time, because there are some issues with the Septuagint, some flaws and errors that are not in the Masoretic. So I'm going to go through now, and let's see here. We lost a couple people. Hopefully they will come back, but if not, then they'll be recorded for them if they're interested. So, okay, Book of Proverbs. One second here, everybody. Let's see. In one of the other teachings that I did, I did the 1 Samuel. I went through 1 Samuel and showed you guys the radical differences. Now I'm going to be going through the Book of Proverbs for you. The King James is basically the Masoretic text. Now hold on, I'm just going to ask Anne if she got kicked off. Okay, so I'm just going to, I'll see if Anne's going to be able to come back, but if not, then it'll be okay. So here I'm going to start going through the Book of Proverbs now. I'm only going to go through the main differences. So we'll start with chapter 1, okay? Chapter 1, verse 7. I'm going to read from the King James Version. It reads, The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. So that's the King James Version. The Septuagint says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and there is good understanding to all that practice it. And piety toward God is the beginning of discernment, but the ungodly will set at naught wisdom and instruction. So you see that? There's a whole extra clause there. The Masoretic one is missing a whole thing. It skips from, it just goes, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of discernment. But the Septuagint says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and there is good understanding to all that practice it, and piety toward God is the beginning of discernment. So it skips from, all the way from, you know, it's, the Septuagint says beginning of wisdom, the Masoretic text skips from wisdom all the way to the second instance of discernment. So right there, that's a whole line missing. Then in verse 18, I'm going to read verse 18 now. Verse 18 in the King James says, and they lay wait for their own blood, they lurk privily for their own lives. The Septuagint says, for they that are concerned in murder store up evils for themselves, and the overthrow of transgressors is evil. So you see, there's some major difference there in translating the Hebrew text. There might be an couple extra words there. Let's see here. I'm going to skip some of these. I just want to focus on the ones which are most important, because I could go through so many, but I don't want to waste the time. So let's see here. Okay, so here's an example. King James of 2, chapter 2, verse 2 reads, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. The Septuagint says, thine ear shall hearken to wisdom, thou shalt also apply thine heart to understanding, and shalt apply it to the instruction of thy son. That final clause is completely missing from the Hebrew text about applying it to the instruction of your son. That's completely missing. Let's see here. Verse 8 says in the King James, he keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints, or holy ones. The Septuagint says, I'm just making sure I read the right thing. It says, that he may guard the righteous ways, and he will preserve the way of them that fear him. So the Hebrew text says, the saints, or holy ones. The Septuagint says, them that fear him. That's major difference. What's the deal with that? You know, how can it be so different like that? There's many other examples where there's some radical differences. I'll start with let me see here, verse 16 of chapter 2. I'm gonna read from 15 to 17, okay, to give you more of a context. Okay, this is King James, whose ways are crooked and they forward in their paths, to deliver thee from the strange woman, even from the stranger which flattereth with her words, which forsaketh the guide of her youth, and forgetteth the covenant of her God. Now in the Septuagint, we see, whose paths are crooked and their courses winding, to remove thee far from the straight way, and to estrange thee from a righteous purpose. Son, let not evil counsel overtake thee of her who has forsaken the instruction of her youth and forgotten the covenant of God. So, you know, the Hebrew text speaks of a strange woman. There's no strange woman in the Septuagint. The Septuagint says the straight way and a righteous purpose. You know, So I'm going through the Book of Proverbs right now, I'm going through the Book of Proverbs and showing some major differences, because there's some like striking differences which suggest that the Hebrew text that we have has been altered significantly, and that the Septuagint is closer to the original. So here's an example, verse 18 of that same chapter, the King James Version. For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead. The Septuagint says, for she has fixed her house near death, and her wheels near Sheol with the giants. That's a major difference. Mentioning the giants, you know, I mean, that's connected with the Enoch stuff of the giants, because that's a major theme of the Enochian writings and the Dead Sea Scroll writings. You could see why someone would remove the reference to giants, because it's not really relevant to a proverb like wisdom, a common wisdom, you know. Let's see here. There's so many differences, so again, I'm only going to the ones which are the most important differences. So I'll go to chapter 3 now. Okay, I'm going to read verse 15 to 16. So this is chapter 3, verse 15 to 16 of the King James. She is more precious than rubies, in all the things thou canst desire are not to be compared unto her. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand riches and honor. The Septuagint says, and she is more valuable than precious stones. No evil thing shall resist her. She is well known to all that approach her, and no precious thing is equal to her in value. For the length of existence and years of life are in her right hand, and in her left hand are wealth and glory. Out of her mouth proceeds righteousness, and she carries law and mercy upon her tongue. So you see right there, let me look quickly again. Like it adds that extra complete extra thing at the end of verse 16. Verse 16 ends with, in her left hand riches and honor. The Septuagint adds after that, out of her mouth proceeds righteousness, and she carries law and mercy upon her tongue. Well, that's pro-law. Wow, that's an amazing thing of supporting the law. And yeah, there's some major differences in Daniel as well, and Genesis. I don't know if we'll be able to do that in this particular one, because those are full studies as well. But we can do that in future studies. We can go through Daniel and Genesis and show all the major differences in the manuscripts. There's verse 22. I'm going to read that, verse 22. King James Version says, so shall they be life unto thy soul and grace to thy neck. Septuagint says, that thy soul may live, and that there may be grace round thy neck, and it shall be health to thy flesh and safety to thy bones. So that's extra clause right there. And then here's verse 28. King James, say not unto thy neighbor, go and come again, and tomorrow I will give, when thou hast it by thee. The Septuagint says, say not, come back another time, tomorrow I will give, while thou art able to do good, for thou knowest not what the next day will bring forth. That whole extra line at the end is not in our Hebrew text, but it's in the Septuagint, and that actually reminds me of something in the New Testament. You know, how he talks about, you don't know what the next day is going to bring. Don't worry about these things, you know. Let's see. Okay. Going to chapter 4 now. Let's see. So it's verse 10. Chapter 4, verse 10. King James says, hear, O my son, and receive my sayings, and the years of thy life shall be many. The Septuagint says, hear, my son, and receive my words, and the years of thy life shall be increased, that the resources of thy life may be many. So there's like an extra detail. It's a little bit repetitive. So you can see why a scribe would condense it just to say, well, it's basically, you know, talking about the life will be increased and many. So let's just shorten it, that one clause. This happens all throughout the scriptures of the different copies. We see the Hebrew text that we have is guilty of condensing the original text significantly because the scribes were getting lazy, or they wanted to make a version where they knew that people would be wanting to read it. Because a lot of people don't want to read things that are redundant and excessive detail. So they were trying to, in a sense, the scribes, some of the scribes actually were getting paid for what they did. And they were selling their work. And in many ways, when you're selling your work, you want people to like what your product is. You want it to be popular with the people. So if you know a version that people will like is one that's short and sweet and to the point, then the scribes would be motivated and justified to say, in their mind, they'd be justified to say, okay, I'm just going to make a shorter version which preserves the main essence of it. But, you know, that's what the people want, so I'm going to give what the people want. And they would get money for that. To me, is the best explanation for why the manuscripts are so different all the time. They had agendas. They had motivations other than preserving his word. They had selfish motivations many of the times. Let's see. Verse 15, King James Version. Avoid it, pass not by it, turn from it, and pass away. In the Septuagint, it says, in whatever place they shall pitch their camp, go not thither, but turn from them and pass away. So it gives more detail about what to avoid from them, from the evil people. Verse 27, this is a good one. This is the final verse of the chapter 4. Turn not to the right hand nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. That's from the King James. The Septuagint says, turn not aside to the right hand nor to the left, but turn away thy foot from an evil way. For God knows the ways on the right hand, but those on the left are crooked, and he will make thy ways straight, and will guide thy steps in peace. So either the Septuagint writer is like making things up and adding ridiculous stuff that's not even there, or the Hebrew text that we have is majorly altering the original and removing stuff. And it gets more distressing seeing all the different things. There's a lot more. Let me see. Okay, I'm going to read verses 19 to 20 of chapter 5. Yeah, someone didn't like lefties, John said. So 19 to 20, it reads, "Let her be as the loving hind and pleasant roe. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times, and be thou ravished always with her love. And why wilt thou, my son, be ravished with a strange woman and embrace the bosom of a stranger?" The 19 to 20 in the Septuagint says, "Let loving heart and thy graceful colt company with thee, and let her be considered thine own, and be with thee at all times, for ravished with her love thou shalt be greatly increased. Be not, my son, intimate with a strange woman, neither fold thyself in the arms of a woman not thine own." So 20 says, embrace the bosom of a stranger. Septuagint says, fold thyself in the arms of a woman not thine own. So, you know, a woman not thine own, that's a stranger. So they just decided to condense it, make it short and sweet, to the point. And let me see, of the verse that I read, what was the main difference there? Okay, I'll move on. Let's see. Sorry of the noise in the background. Okay. I'm just gonna skip. There was another interesting one, but I'm just gonna skip to chapter 6. Because I can't go through everything, because it might take too long. I don't want to waste our time. Let's see. Sorry about the noise in the background again. My apologies. Let's see. All right, I'm going to read verse 8. Okay, this is an amazing one. I'm going to start with verse 6 because that's the context. So verse 6 to verse 8. This is one of the coolest ones I've seen. Chapter 6, 6 to 8. In the King James, it says, "Go to the ant, thou sluggard, consider her ways, and be wise, which, having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provideth her meat in the summer, and gathereth her food in the harvest." The Septuagint says, "Go to the ant, O sluggard, and see, emulate and his ways, and become wiser than he. For whereas he has no husbandry, nor anyone to compel him, and is under no master, he prepares food for himself in the summer, and lays by abundant store in harvest. Or go to the bee, and learn how diligent she is, and how earnestly she is engaged in her work, whose labors kings and private men use for health, and she is desired and respected by all. Though weak in body, she is advanced by honoring wisdom." That entire thing about the bee is not in the Hebrew text. So did the Septuagint writer add a whole proverb about the bee? Or the Masoretic text remove it? And let me tell you, I think the Masoretic text removes it, because here's why. The Bible tells us in 1 Kings that Solomon wrote 3,000 Proverbs. However, in our Book of Proverbs, we are missing, we don't have 3,000 Proverbs. We're missing a lot of those Proverbs. So, there's other Proverbs of Solomon that are not in our Bibles. And so this gives more credence, more plausibility for the Septuagint version being the original, because it has more of the Proverbs. And so, and then there's just so many extra stuff that's like really resonates with the truth in the Septuagint version. It seems unlikely that the Septuagint writer added all these Proverbs into the Book of Proverbs. So, let's see. Verse 11. Okay, I'm going to go to verse 11 now. So, verse 11 reads, "So shall thy poverty come as one that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man." The Septuagint says, "Then poverty comes upon thee as an evil traveler, and want as a swift courier. But if thou be diligent, thine harvest shall arrive as a fountain, and poverty shall flee away as a bad courier." So, you know, there's that whole extra thing about the fountain, poverty fleeing away, you know, none of that's in the Hebrew text. Verse 16. This is chapter 6, but again, verse 16. Hold on one second here. Yeah, that's major difference. Okay. So, it says, verse 16 in the Hebrew text, "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him." The Septuagint says, "For he rejoices in all things which God hates, and he is ruined by reason of impurity of soul." You know, that like seems completely different. Doesn't even mention the numbers of 6 and 7, for instance. You know, that's I don't understand how different that is. You know, I don't know why that happened. Let's see. Okay, and now I'm going to go to verse 7, chapter 7, verse 1, and that reads in the Hebrew, so the King James Version says, it says, "My son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee." The Septuagint says, "My son, keep my words and hide with thee my commandments. Son, honor the Lord, and thou shalt be strong, and fear none but him." So that whole thing, that second sentence is not in our version. Let's see here. Chapter 8 now. And verse 21. I'm going to do verse 21. Actually, King James, "That I may cause those that love me to inherit substance, and I will fill their treasures." I need to read 21 to 22 because they do translate it differently. Okay, King James Version 21 to 22. "That I may cause those that love me to inherit substance, and I will fill their treasures. The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his way, before his works of old. The Septuagint says, I walk in, 21, that I may divide substance to them that love me, and may fill their treasures with good things. If I declare to you the things that daily happen, I will remember also to recount the things of old. The Lord made me the beginning of his ways for his works. So you see the whole thing about, like, fill their treasures with good things. Good things is not in our copies, and then there's like a whole extra sentence there. So it's just very shocking to me, like, how radically different these two versions are, you know? Okay, now I'm going to do verse 12 to 18 of chapter 9. Okay? So chapter 9, verses 12 to 18. Okay, King James Version. If thou be wise, thou shalt be wise for thyself, but if thou scornest, thou alone shalt bear it. A foolish woman is clamorous, clamorous, not glamorous, okay? A foolish woman is clamorous, she is simple and knoweth nothing, for she sitteth at the door of her house, on a seat in the high places of the city, to call passengers who go right on their ways. Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. And as for him that wanteth understanding, she saith to him, stolen waters are sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and that her guests are in the depths of hell, or Sheol. So the Septuagint says, son, if thou be wise for thyself, thou shalt also be wise for thy neighbors. And if thou shouldst prove wicked, thou alone will bear the evil. He that stays himself upon falsehoods attempts to rule the winds, and the same will pursue birds in their fight. For he has forsaken the ways of his own vineyard, and he has caused the axles of his own husbandry to go astray. And he goes through a dry desert, and appointed to drought, and he gathers barrenness with his hands. A foolish and bold woman who knows not modesty comes to want a morsel. She sits at the doors of her house, on a seat openly in the streets, calling to passers-by and to those that are going right on their ways. Whoso is most senseless of you, let him turn aside to me, and I exhort those that want prudence, saying, take and enjoy secret bread and the sweet water of theft. But he knows that mighty men die by her, and he falls in with a snare of perdition. But hasten away, delay not in the place, neither fix thine eye upon her, for thus shalt thou go through strange water. But do thou abstain from strange water, and drink not of a strange fountain, that thou mayest live long, and years of life may be added to thee. So, you know, that's hugely different when you compare it, what that was there. The whole thing about the winds and the birds and vineyard, husbandry, the desert, barrenness, all that's not in the Hebrew text. And then the whole thing about, like, warning, don't fix your eye on her, for strange water, abstain from strange water, drink not from a strange fountain, that you may live long and years of life may be added to thee. None of that's in the Hebrew text. So, you know, that's just so crazy. Chapter 10, verse 1, here's something interesting. In the Hebrew text, in verse 1, it says, at the beginning it says, the Proverbs of Solomon, and then it continues. But wait a minute, I thought the whole book was the Proverbs of Solomon. Why does it say the Proverbs of Solomon in verse 1 there? Well, in the Septuagint, there is no clause, the Proverbs of Solomon, that's missing. So it seems that the Hebrew scribes added that because they, in their mind, the first nine chapters were not Proverbs. They like, oh, this isn't Proverbs, so oh, the Proverbs are starting here. Okay, let's add the clause to let everyone know here. This is the Proverbs. The Septuagint doesn't have that little detail, so it seems likely that the original didn't specify that it was the Proverbs of Solomon in verse 1 of chapter 10. Hold on one second, people. Okay. Okay, verse 4. I'll read verse 4 now. In the King James, it says, "He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich." The Septuagint says, "Poverty brings a man low, but the hands of the vigorous makes rich. A son who is instructed shall be wise, and shall use the fool for a servant." You know, that's maybe someone didn't like that, like using a fool as his servant, because it sounds kind of mean. So you could see that someone might have removed that because they were offended by it. And so, let's see, verse 5. So here's an interesting difference of verse 5. The King James says, "He that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame." The Septuagint says, "A wise son is saved from heat, but a lawless son is blighted of the winds in harvest." A very different translation there. I'm going to skip some of the... There's many other differences, but some of them are differences in the Hebrew, like translating it. So let's see. Okay, here's one. Sorry, but we just got a new dog, and so that's the reason for all the noise in the background. So my apologies. Verse 22 reads, King James, "The blessing of the Lord it maketh rich, and he addeth no sorrow with it." The Septuagint says, "The blessing of the Lord is upon the head of the righteous. It enriches him, and grief of heart shall not be added to it." So, upon the head of the righteous. That's an extra thing, not in our copies. Let's see here. And again, I'm really sorry about the noise in the background. I'm going to do chapter 11, verses 15 to 16. So, chapter 11, verses 15 to 16. In the King James, it says, "He that is surety for a stranger shall smart for it, and he that hateth suretyship is sure. A gracious woman retaineth honor, and strong men retain riches." Okay, that was 15 to 16. The Septuagint says, "A bad man does harm wherever he meets a just man, and he hates the sound of safety. A gracious wife brings glory to her husband, but a woman hating righteousness is a theme of dishonor. The slothful come to want, but the diligent support themselves with wealth." So what do you guys think so far of all these major differences? I'd like to hear your guys' opinion on that before I continue the rest of it. Let's see here. Yeah, please, if you have your reaction of what I've read so far, I'd love to hear, but so I'll try to continue, but let's see. Okay, this is good. 30 to 31 of chapter 11. Okay. King James, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. Behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner. The Septuagint says, out of the fruit of righteousness grows a tree of life, but the souls of transgressors are cut off before their time. If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? That's really different, and that's actually what the New Testament quotes, I'm pretty sure, if I remember correctly. So the differences there were, the Hebrew text said, he that winneth souls is wise. Septuagint says, the souls of transgressors are cut off before their time. That's radically different. And then, it says, behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner. That's completely different. It says, if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? You know, like, so something happened there to the Hebrew text where some Hebrew words were removed or rearranged and stuff, and the Masoretic is very corrupt, whereas the Septuagint is the original, I believe. Okay. Chapter 12, verse 4. King James. A virtuous woman is a crown to her husband, but she that maketh ashamed is as rottenness in his bones. The Septuagint says, a virtuous woman is a crown to her husband, but as a worm on wood, so a bad woman destroys her husband. Okay, verse 9. He that is despised and hath a servant is better than he that honoreth himself and lacketh bread. Septuagint. Better is a man in dishonor serving himself than one honoring himself and wanting bread. That switches it around. You saw that? It says, he that is despised and hath a servant is better than he that honoreth himself and lacketh bread. Whereas it says in here, better is a man in dishonor serving himself. So, you know, that's a major difference in a slant to that verse. Verse 11 now. Verse 11 is in the King James. He that tilleth his land shall be satisfied with bread, but he that followeth vain persons is void of understanding. The Septuagint says, he that tills his own land shall be satisfied with bread, but they that pursue vanities are void of understanding. He that enjoys himself in banquets of wine shall leave dishonor in his own strongholds. So that whole thing about wine is not in the Hebrew text. 13, verse 13. The wicked is snared by the transgression of his lips, but the just shall come out of trouble. Septuagint. For the sin of his lips a sinner falls into snare, but a righteous man escapes from them. He whose looks are gentle shall be pitied, but he that contends in the gates will afflict souls. So that whole extra thing is not in the Hebrew. Let's see. Let me go to chapter 13 now. Okay, 13 verse 1. John says something interesting, and I'll tell you about that in a second, because I want to say one thing. There's some things that are being stated I'm going to clarify, okay? Let me just say this one particular one, and then I'll address what's being said. So verse 1 of chapter 13. A wise son heareth his father's instruction, but a scorner heareth not rebuke. Verse 1 of the Septuagint. A wise son is obedient to his father, but a disobedient son will be destroyed. So, the Hebrew text says, a scorner heareth not rebuke. The Septuagint says, disobedient son will be destroyed. That's kind of more extreme and more harsh, you know? So, it's things like that. It's like, it seems like the Hebrew text altered it to make it more popular of a book. So, yeah, Barbara says it's even worse than the New Testament, but from my studies, it's actually, from my opinion, from what I've studied, it seems the New Testament in general is much better preserved than the Old Testament. Like, so let me clarify what I mean by that. All 27 books of the New Testament have many differences in all the manuscripts. Many differences. But the differences are, relatively speaking, words here and there, sometimes extra sentences, but there's never instances where there's like huge passages missing, for the most part. There's a couple of rare exceptions, or like passages added, things like that, you know. But for the most part, it's usually like a sentence or two, and then sometimes words here and there that are not in the other one, or a slightly difference, you know. But what I found in the books of the Old Testament is that there's much more, like many extra sentences are missing, huge passages sometimes, major differences, but not for every book, but for most of the books. So the question was asked of about the prophets. What about the as I said, the Dead Sea Scrolls for the laws, the law of Moses, is major extra stuff that's not in our version. So that's a huge thing. The law itself has been corrupted and many passages removed. And then the prophets, there are, for some prophets more than others, there are some major differences. Yeah, and in Proverbs and Psalms, the Proverbs is the wisdom of Solomon, for instance. So how do I put it? Solomon was given wisdom by God, and so in one sense you could consider his Proverbs to be inspired in that sense. But we do know Solomon was led astray in many, many, many ways. But so this, the wisdom here of Solomon, there's a lot of wisdom we can gain from it. And then the Psalms, there is actually, the Psalms, the rabbis did not treat the Psalms as prophecy or as prophetic. But the Dead Sea Scrolls in the New Testament treat David's Psalms as prophecy. Like in the Book of Psalms and the Dead Sea Scrolls, it says David wrote all these psalms. He wrote, and it says he wrote many other psalms. In total, 3,600 psalms, 450 songs, for a total of 4,050 songs. And it says that David composed those as divine inspiration. So according to the Dead Sea Scroll writers, they accepted the psalms as divinely inspired. But again, it is different than the prophets straight out, because the prophets focused more on messages to people of like rebuke or a direct message to people, whereas David was more like praising and worshiping. But there were some prophecy in there, but it's a different slant of the prophecy. So yeah, it is. People are saying, you know, it's disappointing that there's so many differences, and it is. It's really disappointing, but what's amazing is that when you start searching these out, it fills your heart with excitement, and there's so much out there that is being hidden with people, and then when you start learning this, it's like coming to the Torah and coming to the scriptures all over again. You're like, you're learning more than you ever thought was there. There's much more we're missing. And when you find out how much is really missing, how much extra stuff we can glean, then it really, in for me anyways, I feel it like it lifts us up and enables us to reach some very impressive conclusions. So, you know, hopefully, I'm going to be going through Proverbs through the rest of this thing. But if you guys, for some of you, if you have other questions on your mind, because, you know, John was saying for him, there are other topics which are more interesting or more relevant to him than the issue of the Book of Proverbs for textual criticism. So if you have other questions, for instance, John, you can ask those questions, and I can address those, like, because I want you to be interested too. I don't want to just you to be bored the entire time. But for me, it's very interesting, and I hope for the others here too, the content of this is interesting. But please, by all means, you can ask any questions, and I'll answer them. And I can go to different topics at any time. So, so let's see. Okay, I'm going to read verses 9 to 15, 9 to 15 of chapter 13. And by the way, we are 1 hour and 20 minutes into this. And usually I do at least an hour and a half. Sometimes I try to approach closer to 2 hours. But if you can't stay the full 2 hours, you can leave sooner. And this is being recorded, so... hold on. What were the verses I said? I said verses 9 to 15. So, okay, King James. The light of the righteous rejoiceth, but the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. Only by pride cometh contention, but with the well-advised is wisdom. Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase. Hope deferred maketh the heart sick, but when the desire cometh, it is a tree of life. Whoso despiseth the word shall be destroyed, but he that feareth the commandment shall be rewarded. The law of the wise is a fountain of life, to depart from the snares of death. Good understanding giveth favor, but the way of transgressors is hard. Okay, the Septuagint in that same passage reads, "The righteous always have light, but the light of the ungodly is quenched. Crafty souls go astray in sins, but just men pity and are merciful. A bad man does evil with insolence, but they that are judges of themselves are wise. Wealth gotten hastily with iniquity is diminished, but he that gathers for himself with godliness shall be increased. The righteous is merciful and lends. Better is he that begins to help heartily, and he that promises and leads to hope. For a good desire is a tree of life. He that slights a matter shall be slighted of it, but he that fears the commandment has health. To a crafty son shall there be nothing good, but a wise servant shall have prosperous doings, and his way shall be directed aright. The law of the wise is a fountain of life, but the man void of understanding shall die by a snare. Sound discretion gives favor, and to know the law is the part of a sound understanding, but the ways of scorners tend to destruction." So that was a lot of verses to go through, so let me just point out the differences in what I just read. And yeah, and John, there are prophecy, there are omissions, and so we can go through some of these Book of Prophecies in the other studies, because I wanna go through each book in some of these studies, you know? I did 1 Samuel in 2 weeks ago, I did 1 Samuel. I think it was actually 3 weeks ago. And this time I'm doing Proverbs. One of these times we'll do one of the prophets. So let me see. Okay, so for instance, here's the King James says, "The light of the righteous rejoiceth." That's what I read. Okay, so we stop there for a second. "The light of the righteous rejoiceth." The Septuagint says, "The righteous always have light." Wait a minute, what? You know, in the one, it's the light that's being the focus. In this one, it's the righteous that's being the focus. And in the Hebrew, it's the King James one. It's rejoiceth, but the Septuagint, instead of rejoice, it's always. How is that? You know, it must be the Hebrew word is slightly different. And then at the end of verse 9, in our text, it just says, the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. The Septuagint says, the light of the ungodly is quenched, and then it adds this whole sentence. It adds, crafty souls go astray in sins, but just men pity and are merciful. And then verse 10 said, only by pride cometh contention. Septuagint translates that as a bad man does evil with insolence. And then the second part of it in the King James, but with the well-advised is wisdom. Septuagint says, but they that are judges of themselves are wise. So that's a major difference there. Let's see here. Verse 11. It says in the King James, it said, he that gathereth by labor shall increase. Septuagint said, he that gathers for himself with godliness shall be increased. So one says labor, the other says godliness. And then the Septuagint adds another thing. It says, the righteous is merciful and lends. And that's not in the Hebrew text. And then verse 12, it says, hope deferred maketh the heart sick, but when the desire cometh, it is a tree of life. The Septuagint says, better is he that begins to help heartily than he that promises and leads to hope, for a good desire is a tree of life. So the one said, hope deferred make the heart sick. The Septuagint said, better is he that begins to help heartily. And when the desire cometh, that's the King James. The Septuagint says, then he that promises and leads to hope for a good desire. So, you know, it's just so many crazy differences. Verse 13 was at the end, it says, he that feareth the commandment shall be rewarded. That's the King James. The Septuagint says, he that fears the commandment has health. To a crafty son shall there be nothing good, but a wise servant shall have prosperous doings, and his way shall be directed aright. So that whole extra thing. And let's see here. Verse 14, the law of the wise is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death. King James. This is some difference. It's Septuagint. The law of the wise is a fountain of life, but the man void of understanding shall die by a snare. So the King James focuses it only on the wise. In the Septuagint, it says, the law of the wise is a fountain of life, but then it talks about the wicked man and what happens to him. So there's a difference of meaning there. And then finally, the verse 15 that I read before, it says, King James, good understanding giveth favor. It's the same thing with the Septuagint. Sound discretion gives favor. But the second part is different. The King James says, but the way of transgressors is hard. That's the King James. The Septuagint for that says, and to know the law is a part of a sound understanding, but the ways of scorners tend to destruction. So that entire thing about the law having the part of a sound understanding. That's just gone. Why did they remove the thing about the law? You know, that's an amazing endorsement of the law, and yet they remove that. If Christian would read that, you know, to know the law is a part of sound understanding. That might lead them to closer to the truth, and yet it's not in their Bibles, so they're not even seeing that. So it's very frustrating how much people are missing. If they had all this stuff, they would start being curious and start looking up some of these things. So I'll move on now. Verses 22 to 23 of that chapter. A good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Much food is in the tillage of the poor, but there is that destroyed for want of judgment. Okay, that doesn't even make sense. The Septuagint says, a good man shall inherit children's children, and the wealth of ungodly men is laid up for the just. The righteous shall spend many years in wealth, but the unrighteous shall perish suddenly. So what are the differences there? The differences were, hold on one second. The differences were, okay, the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. That was the King James. The wealth of the ungodly man is laid up for the just. Okay, that's the same. But then 23, much food is in the tillage of the poor, but there is that is destroyed for want of judgment. The 23 in the Septuagint says, the righteous shall spend many years in wealth, but the unrighteous shall perish suddenly. So that's a huge difference. Anne is saying something. Hold on. Okay, it seems likely that Anne's probably not going to be able to come back, but we'll see if she can. But, okay, so let's see here. Verse 16 of chapter 14. A wise man feareth and departeth from evil, but the fool rageth and is confident. Okay. Septuagint says, a wise man fears and departs from evil, but the fool trusts in himself and joins himself with the transgressor. So that's joining himself with the transgressor is not in our version. And let's see. Okay, verse 22. 22 reads, do they not err that devise evil? But mercy and truth shall be to them that devise good. Septuagint. They that go astray devise evils, but the good devise mercy and truth. The framers of evil do not understand mercy and truth, but compassion and faithfulness are with the framers of good. So, that entire ending of that verse, that entire sentence about the framers of evil not understanding mercy and truth, but compassion and faithfulness are with the framers of good, all that's not in our copies. But that's in the Septuagint copies. Okay, now I'm going to move to chapter 15. As you're seeing, I'm kind of skipping a lot of verses because I'm only going with the most important verses here. Okay, here's one. Verse 1 of 15. A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. Okay. Septuagint, anger slays even wise men, yet a submissive answer turns away wrath, but a grievous word stirs up anger. So that's the extra thing about anger killing wise men. It even kills wise men. That's not in our copies. 4. Okay, verse 4 says, "A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit." This is really different. Septuagint says, "The wholesome tongue is a tree of life, and he that keeps it shall be filled with understanding." So in the one, King James, it says, "Perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit." Septuagint says, "He that keeps it shall be filled with understanding." That's the complete opposite meaning. See. Okay, verse 5. "A fool despises his father's instruction, but he that regardeth reproof is prudent." Septuagint, "A fool scorns his father's instruction, but he that keeps his commandments is more prudent. In abounding righteousness is great strength, but the ungodly shall utterly perish from the earth." So all that stuff about the ungodly perishing and the abounding righteousness and keeping the father's commandments is not in the Hebrew text. And then what's interesting is the Septuagint says, "He that keeps his father's commandments is more prudent." Ours just says, "He that regardeth reproof is prudent." So, you know, that's different because the Septuagint is saying if someone keeps the commandments of his father, he's more prudent. But that doesn't mean he's entirely prudent, because maybe he keeps the commandments of his earthly father, but he's not keeping the commandments of his heavenly father. You know, so the Septuagint changes. Has a difference in that sense. It's talking about the commandments of his father, rather than as the Hebrew text has a different focus of just reproof in general. Let's see here. Verse 18. "A wrathful man stirreth up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeaseth strife." The Septuagint says, "A passionate man stirs up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeases even a rising one. A man slow to anger will extinguish quarrels, but an ungodly man rather stirs up." So that entire extra sentence there. And then... okay, verses 27 to 29 of chapter 15. "He that is greedy of gain troubleth his own house, but he that hateth gifts shall live. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous." The Septuagint says... "A receiver of bribes destroys himself, but he that hates the receiving of bribes is safe. By alms and by faithful dealings, sins are purged away, but by the fear of the Lord, everyone departs from evil. The hearts of the righteous meditate faithfulness, but the mouth of the ungodly answers evil things. The ways of righteous men are acceptable with the Lord, and through them even enemies become friends. The Lord is far from the ungodly, but he hearkens to the prayers of the righteous. Better are small receipts with righteousness than abundant fruits with unrighteousness. Let the heart of a man think justly, that his steps may be rightly ordered of God." What are the differences there? There are some major differences there. If you heard that, that's like, see here. In the Septuagint, it says this whole thing about, it says, "By alms and by faithful dealings, sins are purged away. But by the fear of the Lord, everyone departs from evil." That is considered heretical by many Protestants. They say, wait a minute, no. By alms? By works? By works and by faithful dealings? Dealings means works. By faithful works, sins are purged away. That is a issue people would disagree with. And some of them reject the extra books because, like, for instance, the Book of Tobit. The Book of Tobit says something similar to that, and Sirach says something similar. In the Septuagint, it says this very idea of Proverbs. So people are going to have a hard time with this, but this seems more righteous and more faithful to what the Torah says of your works and what James says. We are saved not just by faith, but also our works working together with faith. So faithful dealings or faithful works. And then, let's see, what was it? It said, heart of the righteous studieth to answer. That was 28, remember? The Septuagint says, the hearts of the righteous meditate faithfulness. So, faithfulness as opposed to answer. Hebrew text says, answer the... Wait, hold on a second. It says, the heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. It seems like it switched the order, because here we see answers is in the second clause. It says, the hearts of the righteous meditate faithfulness, but the mouth of the ungodly answers evil things. So it's just like switched around. And then... in the Septuagint, it has the extra sentence there. It says, the ways of righteous men are acceptable with the Lord, and through them, even enemies become friends. Well, that's not in the Hebrew text. Enemies becoming friends, the ways of righteous men are acceptable with the Lord. Well, what do Protestants say also? They say, the ways of righteous men are filthy rags in his sight. Well, no, that's not what the scriptures say. The ways of righteous men are not filthy rags. They are obedience. They're obeying God's commandments. And so it's acceptable with the Lord or with Yahuwah. There's a major difference there. So verse 29, at the end of it, there's an extra thing that's not in our copies, which says, better are small receipts with righteousness than abundant fruits with unrighteousness. Let the heart of a man think justly that his steps may be rightly ordered of God. That kind of goes against the whole, you know, like, prosperity gospel, because what they say is, you know, unless you have a lot of stuff, it's not that good for you. Solomon tells us it's better to have only small things, you know, receiving only a little bit, but with righteousness, than abundant fruits with unrighteousness. So it's clear that just because you don't have a lot of things does not mean that you are unrighteous. Let's see, so moving on to chapter 16, I'm going to try to skip go through only the most important ones because we're running out of time here. Okay. Let's see, chapter 16, verse 1. Hold on here. There's a problem in this chapter, chapter 16. Some of the proverbs in the Hebrew text are not in the Septuagint, and then some of the proverbs in the Septuagint are not in the Hebrew text. There's like, so something happened here. So how am I gonna do this one? I'm just gonna read verses 1 to 5 first, or 1 to 9, I guess, of 16. The preparations of the heart in man and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. All the ways of a man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirits. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. The Lord hath made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. Every one that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Though hand join in hand, he shall not be unpunished. By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. Ah, there, okay. Better is a little with righteousness than great revenues with right. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. Okay, I see what the problem is. So basically, the Septuagint had those extra proverbs earlier in chapter 15. You heard that? By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. Remember, in the other chapter, it said, by alms and by faithful dealings, sins are purged away, but by the fear of the Lord, everyone departs from evil. That's the same thing right there. And then it says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. Again, that was in the Septuagint, but earlier in the other chapter, it was, the ways of righteous men are acceptable with the Lord, and through them even enemies become friends. And then again, the other thing too that I read was, better, this is in the King James, better is a little with righteousness than great revenues without right. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. And that's what the Septuagint adds in the other chapter. It's better are small receipts with righteousness than abundant fruits with unrighteousness. Let the heart of a man think justly, that his steps may be rightly ordered of God. So the order got switched for some reason in these two chapters. I never realized that. Like, I that was a problem thing. I wasn't understanding why that was there. But I just realized just now as we were going through this what happened. But not only is it in different order, but the Septuagint has extra stuff in chapter 16. So for verse 1, it's the preparations of the heart in man and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. Sorry, hold on a second. I'm going to skip verse 1 because I'm confused about that one. But verse 5, I can do verse 5. King James, everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Though hand join in hand, he shall not be unpunished. The Septuagint says, everyone that is proud in heart is unclean before God, and he that unjustly strikes hands with hand shall not be held guiltless. Same thing so far, but now the whole extra thing. It says, the beginning of a good way is to do justly, and it is more acceptable with God than to offer sacrifices. He that seeks the Lord shall find knowledge with righteousness, and they that rightly seek him shall find peace. All the works of the Lord are with righteousness, and the ungodly man is kept for the evil day. So all that extra stuff's not in our version. Verse 17 now reads, the highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He that keepeth his way preserveth his soul. Septuagint. The paths of life turn aside from evil, and the ways of righteousness are length of life. He that receives instruction shall be in prosperity, and he that regards reproofs shall be made wise. He that keeps his ways preserves his own soul, and he that loves his life will spare his mouth. So that's much longer section. Okay, I'm going to skip now because we're running out of time. Okay, verse 6 of chapter 17. Children's children are the crown of old men, and the glory of children are their fathers. Septuagint. Children's children are the crown of old men, and their fathers are the glory of children. And then here's a whole extra sentence that's not in our version. The faithful has the whole world full of wealth, but the faithless not even a farthing. So that is in the Septuagint. And then let's see here. Okay, verse 13 says, whoso rewardeth evil for good, evil shall not depart from his house. That's the same as the Septuagint. But then, what follows after is, the beginning of strife is as when one letteth out water. Therefore leave off contention before it be meddled with. The Septuagint says, rightful rule gives power to words, but sedition and strife precede poverty. It's a very different translation there. And then verse 16. Wherefore is there a price in the hand of a fool to get wisdom, seeing he hath no heart to it? The Septuagint says, why has the fool wealth? For a senseless man will not be able to purchase wisdom. He that exalts his own house seeks ruin, and he that turns aside from instruction shall fall into mischief. That entire sentence is not in ours. So now I'm going to skip some more of this. Again, skipping lots of stuff. Let's see here. Hold on. Just loading the next chapter. Okay. Okay, let's see. Verse 8. Should I do verse 8? Okay. It's confusing some of this stuff, so I'm going to go to 22. Verse 22. Whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord. Septuagint says, he that has found a good wife, so a good wife, not just a wife, but a good wife, has found favors and has received gladness from God. And then this whole thing is not in ours. He that puts away a good wife puts away a good thing, and he that keeps an adulteress is foolish and ungodly. So it's basically saying, if you are married to an adulteress and you keep her as your wife and she's not repenting of your sin, you're foolish and ungodly if you don't divorce her. That's a major difference. Chapter 19, verse 7. All the brethren of the poor do hate him. How much more do his friends go far from him? He pursueth them with words, yet they are wanting to him. Septuagint says, everyone who hates his poor brother shall also be far from friendship. Good understanding will draw near to them that know it, and a sensible man will find it. He that does much harm perfects mischief, and he that used provoking words shall not escape. So, that's another example there. I'm just going to skip a lot of these. There's some more really interesting ones, but again, I can't go through all these right now because we're running out of time. So what I recommend to you guys is to go through it yourself, because it's some really great stuff. Or I can send you what I did, and you can see the marks I did, and then compare for yourself. Okay, again, there's some really interesting stuff that I gotta skip through most of this. And so chapter 22, verses 8 to 11, okay? Chapter 22, verses 8 to 11. He that soweth iniquity shall reap vanity, and the rod of his anger shall fail. He that hath a bountiful eye shall be blessed, for he giveth of his bread to the poor. Cast out the scorner, and contention shall go out. Yea, strife and reproach shall cease. He that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips the king shall be his friend. So that's 8 to 11. The Septuagint says, He that sows wickedness shall reap troubles, and shall fully receive the punishment of his deeds. God loves a cheerful and liberal man, therefore he shall fully prove the folly of his works. He that has pity on the poor shall himself be maintained, for he has given of his own bread to the poor. He that gives liberally secures victory and honor, but he takes away the life of them that possess. Cast out a pestilent person from the council, and strife shall go out with him, for when he sits in the council, he dishonors all. The Lord loves holy hearts, and all blameless persons are acceptable with him. A king rules with his lips. So let's see here for a second the differences. The difference in 8 was, it said in 8, the rod of his anger shall fail, the Septuagint says, and shall fully receive the punishment of his deeds. And then it adds an extra sentence, God loves a cheerful and liberal man, therefore he shall fully prove the folly of his works. And then in verse 9, it says, at the end of verse 9, Septuagint adds the extra sentence, he that gives liberally secures victory and honor, but he takes away the life of them that possess. That's not in the Hebrew text that we have. And for verse 10, it was, cast out a pestilent person from the council. That's what the Septuagint says. The Hebrew just says, cast out the scorner. It doesn't say from the council, it just says the scorner. And the Hebrew text says, contention shall go out. The Septuagint says, go out with him. For when he sits in the council, he dishonors all. So again, it's talking about the council. And whereas the Hebrew text says, yea, strife and reproach shall cease. Which is not what the Septuagint says at all. That's like very different. And finally, verse 11, says, he that loveth pureness of heart, makes it sound like it's talking about some random person. He that loveth pureness of heart, for the greatness of his lips, the king shall be his friend. Septuagint, on the other hand, says, the Lord loves holy hearts, and all blameless persons are acceptable with him. A king rules with his lips. So that's a really different meaning there. And then verse 14. The mouth of strange woman is a deep pit. He that is abhorred of the Lord shall fall therein. The Septuagint basically says the same thing, but then it adds an extra sentence after and says, evil ways are before man, and he does not like to turn away from them, but it is needful to turn aside from a perverse and bad way. Okay, now I'm going to skip all this, and so verse 22, I'm going to do verse 22 of chapter 24, okay? 22 of chapter 24 reads, for their calamity shall rise suddenly, and who knoweth the ruin of them both? The Septuagint says, it says, this is really different. It says, for they will suddenly punish the ungodly, and who can know the vengeance inflicted by both? A son that keeps the commandment shall escape destruction, for such an one has fully received it. Let no falsehood be spoken by the king from the tongue, yea, let no falsehood proceed from his tongue. The king's tongue is a sword, and not one of flesh, and whosoever shall be given up to it shall be destroyed. For if his wrath should be provoked, he destroys men with cords, and devours men's bones, and burns them up as a flame, so that they are not even fit to be eaten by the young eagles. My son, reverence my words and receive them and repent. All that's not in the Hebrew text. You know, did the guy make that up? I really don't think he made that up. I think that was in the original text and then someone removed that. I find it very hard to believe a Jew decided to add that stuff. So I'm not going to go through the rest, like, to show you the rest of the extra wording, but I'm going to tell you one final thing, which is a major difference, okay? Again, so all the rest of these chapters, there's some major differences that I don't have time to go through, because we're at our end of the study time limit. But basically, what we see in the Septuagint is, after chapter 24, verse 22, comes what corresponds to our Proverbs chapter 30, verses 1 to 14. So that comes next. Proverbs chapter 30, verses 1 to 14. That's in the Septuagint version. That's immediately after verse 22 of chapter 24. So then after the first 14 verses of chapter 30, Proverbs, comes chapter 24, verses 23 all the way to 34. Okay? So that comes. And then what follows after that? Then follows chapter 30, verses 15 to 33. And then after that comes chapter 31, verses 1 to 9 in the Septuagint, okay? So, and then after that comes, then it goes back to chapter 25, and then 26, 27, 28, 29, verses 1 to 27, and then finally, the last section that immediately follows is chapter 31, verses 10 to 31. So, the ending is very different in the order, as well as the Septuagint has many extra passages. So the order is, in our version, it's chapters 24 to 31. In the Septuagint, it's chapter 21, verses 1 to 22, followed immediately after by Proverbs 30, verses 1 to 14, followed immediately after by Proverbs 24, verses 23 to 34. Followed immediately after by Proverbs chapter 30, verse 15, all the way to Proverbs chapter 31, verse 9, and then follows chapters 25 all the way through chapter 29, and then finally the last verses are the same for both chapter 31, verses 10 to 31. So there's some really strange things going on in the book of Proverbs for the order of the of the Proverbs, as well as Septuagint has so much extra proverb stuff, you know? So, but for the Dead Sea Scrolls unfortunately does not preserve enough of the Book of Proverbs. Very little of the Proverbs was preserved. So everything I was reading from was the Septuagint. For the Book of Proverbs, you mainly have to rely on the Septuagint. The Hebrew text of the Dead Sea Scrolls doesn't really help us much at all. And so, where you can get a copy of the translated Dead Sea Scrolls, it's Dead Sea Scrolls Bible. You get that. That's the only English translation right now of the Dead Sea Scrolls out there. It's not the best one, but, it's not the best kind of translation, but it's the best one that it's out there because it's the only one that's out there. And I value that. It's a valuable book, even though I find a lot of iffiness about it in certain instances, but I recommend Dead Sea Scrolls Bible. That's where you should start, and that'll give you the regular books of the Old Testament, Genesis through Malachi, not in that exact order, but you know, those books. It doesn't do Enoch and Jubilees, it just has a little thing about it. It does include Tobit, the Book of Tobit, and a couple other fragments of like Apocrypha, like Sirach and Letter of Jeremiah includes, but otherwise it's just the Old Testament. It does not include the Temple Scroll, for instance, but it does include the extra long version of the Psalms, Book of Psalms, and that one's pretty cool. So get the Dead Sea Scroll Bible. It's really cheap. It's not very expensive. You can find it on Amazon, and then you have to compare it yourself though to the to the King James or whichever one you're using, and you'll see the major differences. But I recommend the Septuagint because that's really key, because the Dead Sea Scrolls didn't preserve everything because we are missing so much. We only have fragments very often, much of the time. So get the Dead Sea Scroll Bible, and then I recommend getting Brenton's Septuagint. That's a good one, but also get what's called a New English Translation. New English Translation of the Septuagint. That one is really good. And then you can just compare because there's so much stuff. But if you don't have a lot of time to do the comparisons yourself, then what you can do is wait until I do them, because I've already done them and I'm making versions as we speak. You know, I'm going to be making them in the future and providing them for free to people. So you can wait so that you don't have to, you know, waste time in one sense. If you have a lot of responsibilities to do, you can wait until I do all the work for you guys, like pointing out the differences side by side, stuff like that. Really in-depth stuff I plan to do in the future. But if you want the full text, I just say get the Septuagint and read that and study that as if that was the best version, because I really think most of the time the Septuagint is the best of what has been preserved. So that's it for the presentation. Is there any final questions you guys have before we end this? Please share right now. But otherwise, yeah, I'll definitely be doing a side-by-side. Right now, what the document that I have, what I did is I used the Septuagint as the main text, and then I underlined the parts which were different from the other versions. I've done that for the entire Old Testament except for Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. I've gone through and I've listed, like, I did my main version, and then I did underlining to show you all the differences, all the main differences. So you can, I have it on Facebook available. There was a couple things about it that I, you know, certain errors that I did, for instance, you know, not everything was perfect about it, and then I was trying to figure out how to render God, or, you know, Elohim, and I replaced God with Supreme, but now I think that's kind of stupid that I said Supreme, but it's in the PDF file, so you'll always see, like, Supreme there, but it's gonna take, it would take a lot of time to fix it from Supreme to Elohim or something like that. I haven't gotten a chance to do that yet, so, it says Supreme, but other than that, it's pretty good. I think you would find it really valuable. Yeah, and that's a good way to do El as well, yeah, for God in the singular, and Elohim, yeah. So, it's on my Facebook group, for those who want it. It's the Essene Jewish Bible Project. That's my group on Facebook. You could also just message me on Facebook, Onia, you can find me there, and I'll send you the PDF file. All right. Again, any final questions? Or otherwise, that's it for this, and I hope you enjoyed my presentation of the Book of Proverbs, and that you thoroughly enjoyed the content, because I know it's difficult for all this information, because, wow, like, so much is different, but we see there's more to his word. Let's find it out, and let's learn from it, and grow from it. So, all right, thank you all. I very much appreciate you attending. And I hope you come next week. This is going to be on Sundays. I'm going to try to do it every week, Sunday at the same time, 9 p.m. on my time zone. All right, shalom, guys. Thank you all again. Sure, I can, perhaps I can do something, a better presentation in the future, like more, information and more, what you just said, a bigger screen. So, all right, thank you. See you next week. Shalom.